Hello, myself Abhishek Awad, working as Assistant Professor, Police Administration in Raksha Shakti University, Ahmedabad. This university is the first internal security and police university of India. Today I will talk on the topic Terrorism Present Challenges Before Police and Security. The world has witnessed different dimensions and dynamics of terrorism in the recent decades. Terrorism has become the global problem and threat for most of the countries of the world, especially developed and rapidly developing countries. India itself is struggling hard with this menace since last three decades. The study on terrorism shows that terrorists have concentrated their targets on India's political, economical, social and religious setup with different strategies each time. This changing means and mode of terrorist attacks have posed different challenges before the police and security. Some of these challenges are maintenance of peace and order, border and coastal security, protection of critical infrastructure and vital installations. VIP security, cyber security are also some of the emerging challenges. Maintenance of peace and order. Peace and security is the most essential ingredients for the progress and growth of any society and nation at large. The industrialization and urbanization cannot take place until and unless the law and order condition of that particular place is reasonably good or satisfactory. The innocent and illiterate people are often instigated and misguided by the terrorist groups on the ground of caste and community, religion, region, which further leads to communal violence, public disorder, riots and unrest. The other factors which are responsible for the disturbance of peace and order on the communal ground may be summarized as socio-economic factor. Due to educational backwardness, some communities have not been able to represent themselves adequately in the public and private services, leading to relative deprivation and discontent, which results in caste and communal conflict in the society. People who are fanatic in their religious belief do not enthusiastically participate in secular nationalistic approach and insist on maintaining their separate identity. Sometimes Orthodox members of other communities feel that they have a distinct entity with their own cultural pattern, personal laws and thoughts process. The groups of people having such conservatism and fundamentalists often create law and order problem and destabilizes nation's growth and development. The political factors are that the present vote bank politics focusing on the specific caste and community based agendas have divided the citizens of the country under various caste, religion, region and communities. Lack of liberal, progressive and modern attitude in different communities have also weakened the cause of communal harmony. Organized criminal and terrorist is the third factor. The organized criminals and terrorists play a key role in acting as agents of vested interest in instigating communal riots. The bomb blast in Mumbai in 1993 that killed around 300 people and attack on Akshardham temple in Gujarat in 2002 by terrorist outfits such as Lashkar-e-Taiba and Jaish-e-Mohammed, targeted to spread communal riots in the country. The social media also plays a very important role. Social media refers to internet-based communication among people who create, share, and exchange their ideas, photos, videos, and information on virtual cyber platform. Social media includes Facebook, Twitter, YouTube, blogs, etc. India now has more than 200 million internet users, which can be targeted by the terrorist groups for spreading rumors, instigating riots, and using it for various terrorism and anti-national activities. The demographic factors are that India is a nation of different demographic structure. The demographic differences of each state are used by the terrorist groups for manipulation of communal sentiments, for creating hatred with their fellow citizens of the country. Now, the second challenge is border and coastal security. The management of the coastal and border security in respect to the terror threats posed by the terrorist is a complex proposition for the police and security personnel. India shares approx 15,000 kilometers of boundary with her immediate neighbors. Pakistan, it covers 3,323, China 3,458, Bhutan, Myanmar, and Bangladesh. India's international boundary with each of her neighbors runs through a various complex problems and has its own unique settings and dynamics. Thus, the challenges in the border and coastal areas may be enumerated under following heads: infiltration and illegal movement across the border. Infiltration is defined as sneaking across a border, making clandestine entry in the domain of the opposing party. Infiltration of foreign nations from the bordering countries into Indian territories has given rise to the border crimes. The situation further becomes alarming due to the nexus of the criminals and terrorists who commits border crimes in a much organized manner. More than ever before, groups engaged in terrorism and organized crime know to operate together. These relationships have helped terrorist groups to be less dependent on state sponsors. The Kashmir and Punjab borders are the most targeted Indian border for infiltration. Infiltrators are sent to destabilize the internal security, as in the case of Pakistan, sending armed infiltrators into Kashmir Valley and Punjab. Now, the trafficking, the activity of buying and selling goods or people illegally, is called trafficking. There are various types of trafficking, which includes drugs trafficking, human trafficking, arms trafficking, etc. The border areas are the most preferred route for all types of trafficking. Arms trafficking, the trafficking and proliferation of arms and ammunition is an immediate security challenge to the police and security, as these arms are used by the terrorists to create hurdle to sustainable growth and progress of the country. Arms trafficker groups procure the arms and ammunition from South Asian market through the countries like Bangladesh, Myanmar, and Nepal to finally send those trafficked arms to the borders of Punjab and Rajasthan. These arms are sold to insurgents groups, smuggling syndicates, drug syndicates, armed gangs, and fundamentalists organization. Arms trafficking have gradually increased in Indian subcontinent due to increase in terrorist and anti-social activities and the spread of low intensity conflicts. India today is facing a problem of rise in arms holders. The use of small arms is so rampant in India that it has become a major factor affecting the national security. Drug trafficking of drugs take place overwhelming throughout land borders, followed by sea and air routes, with the Golden Crescent and Golden Triangle in India's neighboring. The drug trafficking poses yet another threat to our security and police. Drug syndicates are generating huge funds, a part of which is being used to give financial support to some of these subversive groups. The intelligence agencies like the ISI are recruiting a number of carriers in drug trafficking as their agents. These agencies provide legal immunity for their criminal activities in their own country, in addition to giving them financial and logistical support. Proximity to the largest producer of heroin and hashish, the Golden Triangle and Golden Crescent, which includes the country like Afghanistan, Pakistan, Iran, has made India's border vulnerable to drug trafficking. Indigenous production of low-grade heroin as well as various psychotropic and prescription drugs and their growing demand in the neighboring countries and international market have added a new dimension to the problem of drug trafficking. Trends and patterns of drug trafficking in the country demonstrate that there is a gradual shift from traditional natural drugs towards synthetic drugs that are being trafficked. The human trafficking is being means selling and buying men and women like goods in India. Trafficking of men, women and children is an awful crime that has violated the livelihood of the individuals and privileges of the freedom guaranteed by the Constitution. It has even emerged as a threat to the nation's peace, security, and stability. The trafficked women are being used by the terrorists for various illegal purposes, like for honey trap, in drug peddling, for pushing the counterfeit currency into the market, etc. Given the transnational dimensions of human trafficking, it has the potential to destabilize the democratic political system. The challenge of human trafficking, therefore, cuts across national boundaries and requires collective initiatives. In other words, the scale and the nature of such an endemic socio-economic problem surpass the capability and jurisdiction of national government, thus necessitating more comprehensive prevention, control and response framework that hinges on strategic regional sub-regional cooperation. The advantage to the traffickers in this business is that since human beings are not degradable elements, they can be resold again. Unfortunately, the social stigma attached to it, especially in the Indian context, is so deep rooted that the trafficking victims simply fall in to live a normal life thereafter. The current approaches in combating human trafficking through administrative and legal measures like prevention, prosecution, protection and rehabilitation have not provided satisfactory results. Illicit trafficking flourishes as an underreported crime, eating into the vitals of the Indian nation in a clandestine fashion and is spreading its tentacles beyond the borders. As a result, the need for a comprehensive strategy to counter the hazards that threaten the security of the nation is arising, therefore, while dealing with the scourge of human trafficking. The concerned stakeholders need to consider the imperative of revisiting the current policies and actions and further discuss the various response options. Now, the third challenge before the police and security is security, coastal security, which are inter and run deep inside the land borders, the coastlines, procured and hence vulnerable to cross-border terrorism. In recent years, the use of sea by terrorists to carry out attacks, as was seen during the 1993 Mumbai serial blast and the November 2008 attack on Mumbai, have also added a new dimension to the vulnerability of the coastal area of our country. The security scenario along the coastline gets much more sensitive due to existence of several high value targets such as oil refineries, atomic power plants, space stations, ports and naval bases along the coastline. There is growing worry about terrorist attacks on the vital installations near shoreline, which could potentially inflict massive damage. Strategic location of the island territories in terms of their proximity to the important sea lanes of communication and Southeast Asian and African countries, coupled with considerable distance from the mainland, increases the vulnerability. In recent years, intelligence reports have suggested that many uninhabited islands are being misused by terrorist groups and criminals gangs as smuggling arms and narcotics. The Andaman and Nicobar Island have seen large scale influx of illegal migrants from Bangladesh, Sri Lanka, Myanmar, Thailand and Indonesia. So these coastal security challenges before the police and other coastal forces make imperative to devise foolproof coastal security system to tackle any terror attack in future. Now the fourth one is the protection of critical infrastructure and vital installations. Industrial assets and various energy production facilities are widely spread out across the country. Safeguarding transportation modes and assets that has large public footfall requires considerable allocation of physical security and application of technology. Critical infrastructure sectors provide the foundation for national security, governance, economic, vitality and way of life for the country. Furthermore, their continued reliability, robustness and resiliency create a sense of confidence and form an important part of our national identity and purposes. The critical infrastructure frame our daily lives and enable us to enjoy one of the highest overall standards living in the world. The facilities systems that comprises our critical infrastructure are highly sophisticated and complex. They include human assets and physical and cyber systems that work together in process that are highly interdependent. They also consist of key nodes that in turn are essential to the operation of the critical infrastructure in which they function. Amongst vital installation, we can classify the following vital installations such as airports, ground transportation which includes rail, metro and bus, power plants which includes nuclear, hydro, thermal power plants and agriculture and food industry, water, public health, emergency services, defense, industrial base, telecommunications, energy, chemicals and hazardous materials. The January 2, 2016 attack on the Pathankot Air Force Station in Punjab underscored the determination of our terrorist enemies. They learn from experience and modify their tactics and targets to exploit perceived vulnerabilities and avoid observed strengths. Security increases around more predictable targets. They shift their focus to less protected assets, enhancing countermeasure. As for any terrorist or targets, therefore makes it more likely that terrorists will favor another attack. Cyber security and its management. Cyber security can be defined as protection of system, networks and data in cyber space. It refers to the preventive methods used to protect information from being stolen, compromised or attacked. Cyber security demands for multiple approaches, initiatives and responses to ensure and assure the safe functioning of the networks and systems in the cyber space. In present scenario, cyber security has emerged as a greatest challenge for ministries and departments of the government, as it is one of the most targeted areas for collecting confidential information and espionage. The enhancement of the information technology and commercial applications of cyberspace has certainly made the life easier and faster, but simultaneously it has also made the people vulnerable for getting victimized of the cyber crime. Hacking and identity theft is common nowadays. Threats to India's cyberspace. India is most vulnerable to cyber attacks since it doesn't have any foolproof security system and is still dependent on the basic security features. The entire cyberspace is almost unprotected. So it is high time to protect all our vital institutions, critical infrastructure and critical information infrastructure from cyber attacks. Critical information infrastructure is broadly defined as including those networks which are interrelated, interconnected and interdependent. Cyber security management in India. A list of critical computer infrastructure has been defined by the Government of India, which requires a special protection against the cyber attacks. It includes all the networks related to the national security, defense, banks, stock markets, power grids, railways, airlines, etc. The national policy on cyber security has been framed in 2013 under the Department of Electronics and Information Technology, working under Ministry of Communication, and information technology. Government of India, this National Cyber Security Policy 2013 has the following missions. It is to protect information and information infrastructure in cyber space, to build capabilities to prevent and respond to cyber threat, to reduce vulnerabilities, to minimize the damage from cyber incidents through a joint effort of institutional structure, people, process, technology, and cooperation. The main objective of National Cyber Security Policy 2013 is to create a secure cyber ecosystem in the country that may generate adequate trust and confidence in IT systems and transactions in cyber space. The second objective is to create an assurance framework for design of security policies and promotion and enabling actions for compliance to global security standards and best practices by way of conformity assessment. The third objective is to enable effective prevention, investigation, and prosecution of cybercrime and enhancement of law enforcement capabilities through appropriate legislative intervention. The next objective is to enhance the protection and resilience of nation's critical information infrastructure by operating a 24/7 National Critical Information Infrastructure Protection Center, which is called NCIIPC, and mandating security practices related to the design, acquisition, development, use and operation of information resources. The next objective is to encourage to adopt guidelines for procurement of trustworthy ICT products and provide for procurement of indigenously manufactured ICT products that have security implications. Now, the National Technical Research Organization, which is called NTRO, is being declared as the nodal agency for the protection of critical information infrastructure of India. NTRO has identified 17 subsectors initially and has started activities for 7 subsectors and organizations mentioned below: air traffic management, which is called ATM, civil aviation for transportation, power grid for energy, Mahanagar Telecom Nigam Limited, MTNL, Bharat Sanchar Nigam Limited, BSNL, Railways, State Bank of India. All of the above organization which has been identified as a critical sector should nominate a nodal officer for the post of Chief Information Security Officer, CISO, for interaction with NCIIPC. CISO will be the point of contact for NCIIPC. Role and responsibility of Chief Information Security Officer thus becomes very crucial, and CISO would be responsible for assisting senior management in the development, implementation, and maintenance of an information security infrastructure building, an information security culture developing, communication, and ensuring compliance with organizational information security policy standards and guidelines, ensuring regulatory and standards compliance, developing security awareness and training program, periodically conducting internal audit to check compliance with organizational security policies, standard and guidelines, risk management, incident management, business continuity management, assisting senior management in acquisition of products, tools and services related to information and related to technology. The next challenges before police and security is the VIP security, Terrorism has added a huge dimension to the security of VIPs globally. Terrorists are well organized, well trained, heavily armed and fully motivated. They carry sophisticated weapons and explosives devices, have modern communication equipment and follow a well rehearsed and timed operation. They also have the element of surprise on their side. The terrorists have a well rehearsed and timed operations. They also have the element of surprise on their side. The attack on the Indian Parliament on December 13, 2001 exemplifies such situation. Five terrorists dressed in a commando fatigues entered the well protected and fortified Parliament House precincts in a car through a manned gate on the strength of the forged car sticker at a time when both houses of Parliament had just adjourned for the day. The terrorists were heavily armed with automatic weapons, grenades and explosives and fired at security personnel. They also made a frantic bid to enter the main building of the Parliament House, which had that point time senior ministers and over 200 members of Parliament. The prompt response of the security personnel and Parliament staff saved the political leaderships of the country. The five terrorists were killed, but on the cost of life of our police officers and Parliament staffers and casualties of several others. The daring attempt brings home the vulnerability of VIPs and the high level of motivation and well-planned strategies of the terrorist to kill the VIPs. Another dimension to terrorist attacks is suicide bombers. They are highly motivated and wear suicide explosive jackets ready to push the button at will. Car bombs or bombs hidden at strategic locations and explode through remote control or hidden devices are other dimensions of terrorist attacks. This has serious ramifications on VIP security. Provisions of foolproof security for the VIPs therefore becomes one of the most challenging tasks for the police and security of any country. VIP protection, planning, strategies and tactics have to provide solutions in such an alarming scenario. The police and security agencies therefore need to be given great support and strength by all, including the public, that can play the role by vigilance in day-to-day life on unusual movement of suspicious persons or presence of suspicious objects. The VIP security throughout the world poses a tremendous responsibility on police and security agencies to counter any threat to VIPs. Its effectiveness can be ensured only by thorough professionalism of a strong security apparatus, development of actionable intelligence, its timely sharing and analysis, and public support. To counter all the present challenges of terrorism, India needs a new vision and approach with public-private partnership for revamping its setup of internal security comprehensively. There is an urgent need of developing the specialized institution wholly devoted and dedicated for finding out the new solutions for tackling all the aforesaid challenges of terrorism. In this regard, the establishment of regional police training institutions can play a pivotal role in imparting training to the police personnel of those states which have interstate linkages in internal security and faces the problems of similar nature, such as border and coastal crimes in border and coastal states of India. The Police Internal Security University can play significant role in imparting knowledge pertaining to internal security and policing to the students. interested in knowing the various dynamics and dimensions of internal security. In this way, a pool of trained manpower can be generated for tackling the future challenges of terrorism. These universities could also do the action-oriented research to find out the problems and solutions in field of internal security and policing. These universities can also act as center for consultancy in the field of internal security challenges and may emerge as center of excellence in the field of internal security. The emerging concept of smart policing may be realized through the extensive use of science and technology in tackling the various challenges of terrorism. For this, we need to develop professional competency among the police and security force by giving specialized training and enhancing their skills in counter-terrorism. Thank you.